All right, so as I think Melanie just said, but I will repeat it, I am a developmental psychologist, and I study the role of sensory motor development in cognitive development, in world learning, in language, in attentional processes, and in memory processes. And one role that sensory motor development plays, and the one that I want to talk about today, is that it constrains and structures and orders experience. That is the data for learning and the basis of all our knowledge. And if you think about it, okay, most of the knowledge that we want to acquire about the world models that we want to build, is actually latent in the world. It's not available to us unless we physically act on that world. And physically acting on that world requires the body and the brain. So I think this leads to really radical and transformational ways, or maybe smarter ways than we've been doing in the past, at least, of thinking about embodiment and the relation between the mind and the brain. All right, so that's my intro here. At each moment in time, there is a link between the internal system, what we might want to call the mind, and at each moment in time, the state of that mind is playing a direct role in determining what our experiences are. The brain both generates behavior, controls the sensory inputs that are learned, that are available to it, and it determines what is learned, okay? This is a real mix-up of everything, okay? Inseparable. And it's the activations within the brain tied to the brain's own intrinsic dynamics and to generated behaviors and sensory inputs that changes the brain. Each moment, what we do, what we receive for information, what new ideas, representations, memories, whatever you want to call them, we form, is tied to the brain's own intrinsic dynamics, to its history, and to the generated behaviors and sensory inputs at that moment. So knowledge is just instantiated in the system, and I don't know that we can think of it as separate. So given these kinds of ideas, actually, I don't know what their idea is, given these facts, okay, there's an important sense of embodiment, which is really permeates everything about human cognition. And I don't think it's about grounding, and I don't think it's about sensory motor representations. And I don't think that it's about a debate between percepts versus concepts as separate kinds of information or as related kinds of information. But I think embodiment is actually more important and much deeper than we have actually given it thought. So here's what I want to do. I want to tell you about my work, a little bit about my work and what leads me to this. And then I'm going to come back to some of the issues that have been raised in previous talks over the past 2 days, or ask you to come back to them, hopefully. So first, I'm going to talk about how bodily development determines an infant curriculum, creates an infant curriculum for learning, which says a lot about how we turn out as we are, as forms of human intelligence, that the real-time behavior of the infant actually creates the data for learning in the moment in ways that are revealing. And then third, that because behavior is a physical thing and a physical world, it is tightly constrained by space, time, and context, and it creates systems of knowledge that, in fact, reflect space, time, and context in deep and important ways. We only have a little bit of time here, so I'm going to go through these, try to make the big points, okay? All right, so as many of you know, what I do, this is what I do for my living, is I put wearable sensors on babies in an effort to capture real world experience as they create it in the moment in their everyday lives. We do this in three major ways. One is we wire them up with all kinds of sensors in the lab, motion sensors, head-mounted eye trackers, audio sensors, heart, we're now doing autonomic sensors, get everything in the moment, okay? That's in the lab. It's high resolution, sort of naturalistic, but the kit is wired. The other thing we do is we do a lesser thing in the laboratory, which is a toy room play. This is free-flowing, cluttered parents and infants play together by themselves in a room for extended durations of 10 minutes to 30 minutes. And they just wear head-mounted eye trackers or head cameras. And then the two big efforts are Home View and India View, where we put head cameras and audio recorders on babies and try to get day-long recordings of everyday life, okay? And we have lots of data, okay? All right. So the first point I want to make is that bodily development determines the curriculum for learning. What babies can do at different points in development, what their bodies can do, how their sensory systems work, they change markedly. And they absolutely determine the data, the interactions, the sensory input. And this is a strong evolutionary constraint on how knowledge is acquired, this ordering. So early in development, infants' visual acuity is not good. They can't do a great deal other than move their eyes motorically. And when you look at what they see a lot of faces. That's because their parents love them, which is evolutionarily pushed there too. And a lot of edges, kind of Gabor filter, simple kind of stuff, like maybe that B1 and B2 loves. As they get a little older, when they are getting a little more autonomous, but not as autonomous as they could be, they see big cluttered parts of the world and they spend hours just watching it because they can't do that much. And then when they hit their first birthday, they really start controlling their input in remarkable ways. And I'm going to talk a little bit about all of these. And I like to show this video just as a quick, we did this for different reasons. That's why the top says sparse and the bottom says ordinary. But this is sampled at every 5 seconds from about 300 hours of head camera video. And they're in order every 5 seconds. And if you look for a minute at the 3-month-old videos, you see a lot of faces, ceilings, lights, edges. If you look at the middle ones, the 6 to 8-month-olds, you see a lot of, at the bottom there, kind of regular scenes, but odd points of view of them. And because they're beginning to crawl and they're trying to see up on the sparse ones, you see lots of floors. And then when you get over to the 11 to 12 month olds, these scenes now start looking like maybe something somebody would take from a camera, right? They have real pictures. You can sort of see what's going on here, and they're organized in the vertical with gravity going the right direction. Okay. All right. So this is a little curriculum. What is it doing? All right. Well, one of the first things that's absolutely true in the data, this is one of the first papers we put out on this point, but it's been shown in lots of ways, and it's true for the data collected in India as well as the data collected in the US, is that early in experience, babies see a lot of faces. Each one of those dots is an individual child, and that's the mean of their corpus of faces and day-long recordings. And early in development, under 4 or 5 months, babies, 15 minutes out of every waking hour is a face, okay? By the time you get up to 16 months or 24 months, it's much, much less. At 24 months, faces are in view less than 4 minutes per hour on average after 2 years of age, okay? They're not as dominant out there as you might think. On the other hand, hands go the other way. Early on, these are everybody's hands, your own, and other people's. And early, under 5 months of age, hands are very, very infrequent. By the time you get to 2 years of age, it goes way up at the first mark, coming up to about 10 to 15 minutes an hour. But by the time you get two, it's like 20 minutes an hour. In fact, hands are the most dominant things in people's experiences, your hands and other people's. So why is this important? What is this telling us? Okay. Why does it seem like it? Well, all right. So first of all, what I've just told you, these are some pictures of the head images. The contents of visual experience change from dense with faces to dense with hands. And why is that important? Okay. Well, it's important because development has to build on whatever's gone before, okay? The brain doesn't stop and restart, it doesn't reboot, it doesn't reset. Everything gets built on. When you think about what we know about the visual system, everybody is coming up through the early layers, every input, the early layers in that input, B1, B2. Every visual input comes through there. We know that they are massively tuned, these early layers, by infant experience, and that it really matters, that if you have a cataract young or other kinds of disturbances in the input, it has lifelong consequences, okay? Because the neural circuitry does not get shaped right. And if you really want to read about that, you need to look at Daphne Maurer's work. It's absolutely fascinating, okay? So that means we have an early visual system here that is trained by faces. It's trained by faces, okay? And then that means when you go on to start handling objects and learn about objects and spend your time doing that, it is built on top of a visual system that is shaped by what you've already experienced. And that's a heavy dose of up close faces. So I want to go back, say one more thing before I say that. So the point I want to make here is that this curriculum, which is shaped by this developing sensory motor system and tightly constrained and highly systematic, these constraints across development and culture, sensory motor development is really a well-organized, tightly constrained by evolution process, is structuring what's learned first, what's built upon it, what comes next, okay? The fact that you couldn't do much as a baby is shaping the way you think right now, okay? Is what I want to say in some deep, long way out way, okay? Now, if we go to the hand, the period when children start using their hands to really control their visual input and to explore and to act on objects and to find out what objects can do, which starts becoming dominant at about 8 months to really getting powerful at 12 months of age. What it does is it creates the data for learning. And I just want to go through this little thing here. Look at this, okay? You have big cluttered worlds. Everybody talks about how messy the world is. This is a 12-month-old. Okay, playing with that ring, it's not cluttered at all. It's not visually ambiguous as to what's going on. And that interest invites input from the parent. That behavior on that child's part is creating visual information for learning. It is inviting comments from the parent. And it all depends on the hands and the head and the trunk. Okay, so I wanted to go through quick some experiments that we've done that make the point as to how foundational this all is to human learning. So what we did in these experiments is we put babies and parents together. This is the highly wired up experiment. And they're playing together at a tabletop, head-mounted eye trackers, motion sensors, the whole deal. And we had the mom play with the baby. These are 18-month-olds in this picture, with novel objects that we made up that we gave novel names to. And the parents, we're not told that we're going to test object name learning afterwards, but just to play with the objects. And if they name them, to use these names, which the parents have been taught in a prior kind of little task bit. And afterwards, we tested the children's learning of the object names in a forced choice test where we'd say, get the Zeebee. And they would could reach for it or could look at it as their possible measures. what we did was we looked backwards in time. We said, let's take every instance of an object name that a child learns, or perhaps this child learned ZB but did not learn MAPU. We would go back in time and we'd look at all the naming experiences for ZB. What were their properties? What did they look like, okay, in terms of their sensory motor properties, those naming experiences? And we would compare them to the cases where the child had not learned the name. So we're going to look at the bottom-up information for when they learned the name, the sensory motor information, versus when they did not, okay? And these are those sensory motor properties. These are the visual properties. We measured them, the visual properties, over from 20 seconds before the naming moment till 20 seconds after. That's a very long time. Backwards, okay. And we're comparing learned versus unlearned. Blue are the properties of the named object. Red are the properties of the other competitors in view. So this is visual size. Is as you can see, when the object name was learned, it was bigger in the view. Why is it bigger? because the child was holding the object close to them because they were interested in it, getting a good view, and the parent named it at that moment. But if the parent named it at a moment where the object was smaller in the view, it was not learned, okay? And this is overlap with center. When children sustain attention and look at objects, they look at them. This is in the 3D world with head and eyes aligned. And that is actually a big factor for learning, is to have your head and eyes aligned. You don't learn very well, you know, if you get everything kind of looking weird. You can try that. You can't even hold that very long, you know, looking at the, you know, moving your head in one direction, your eyes in the other. And so these infants learn the object names when the named object is centered, then when it is not, okay, in this case. The other thing I want you to notice here is how long these properties last. These are reliable differences over 5 seconds. That is, it's not like an instantaneous, you hear the name and what's the property of the object at that moment. I mean, this is real bodies in physical worlds. These are 5 to 7 second differences in the timing of the advantages for the name, for the target over its competitors. And all of this is a direct consequence of how toddlers' bodies and their sensory motor systems work. And we actually know a lot about it, and I'm just going to go through it rapidly here and tell you. The advantages for the named object over the competitors that support actual learning from this task of a single name of an object depend on the stability of the child's head. If they're moving their head, wiggling around, okay, they can't do it, okay? Head stability is a big issue, and it's a big issue in atypical development, okay? Just put that in your mind, okay? They are more likely, the visual properties alone are not the only thing that matters. Holding also matters. Now, it could be because they're getting a second modality of information in there. I believe that. But it's also because the hands, heads, and eyes are connected, and heads are way more likely to be stabilized, okay, if you're holding an object in front of you at midline. There's a lot of work on that by a lot of great people, okay? You stabilize your head and body by holding, okay? It's a whole system in and of itself, whole sensory motor system. Secondly, head and eye alignment supports learning, okay? And you're more likely to keep your head and eye aligned when you're holding an object, okay? All right, this is just straight up body stuff, but it's essential to learning your first object name. Whoops. Now, when children are holding objects, I also want to mention, it's not like they're holding it and just staring at it like you would a picture. They are actually generating changing views of the object, okay? They are active holders and active lookers. So this is not, don't think of it as they're staring at a picture, okay? So despite the fact that it's stabilized, centered in the head and in view for a period of time, it is active sensory visual information changing, but all focused on the object. And one of the things that we know about it is that when children are holding objects or playing with them, they actually generate highly biased views. The views they generate are ones in which they elongate the axes of elongation and the axes of symmetry of the object, and in which they rotate that object in depth. And it certainly gets better as their holding abilities get better. So 1 year olds don't show such robust hot spots. This is the all possible views of an object you could see. It's like taking the globe of the world and spreading it flat, okay? So this is this whole sphere around the object, and you can see they spend their time on hot spots, okay? On particular viewpoints, and those viewpoints are one what are called the planar views of objects, okay, in which the major axes are either perpendicular or parallel to the line of sight. And they spend their time, these are the smears, okay, rotating the object in depth. That is, they're not doing frontal views and, you know, whatever, they're rotating the objects in depth. And if you go back and read more, whatever else you think of him, he's probably right in saying these are the geometrically important objects are best exposed around the axes of symmetry and elongation. Just because I always get asked this little smear down here, the difference, one of the big differences between 1 year olds and 2.5 year olds is 1 year olds don't hold objects upright. Top bottom means nothing to them. It's not aligned with gravity. This is just the little train and upright versus upside down, which older children don't do so much. They've already got canonical views in mind, but these are highly biased views. And our work has shown that these highly biased views lead to better object memory, better learning, and better generalization of the object name. So the bias structure in the self-generated view, there's now quite a bit of evidence that suggests this, predicts learning, memory, generalization. It is building probably abstract, well, not probably, it is building abstract representations. I have that in quotes because I don't know what that word means, but the performance of the children suggests that they can generalize to unseen shapes and generalize by sparse descriptions or abstract descriptions of 3D geometry. And other work indicates that all this is the basis for one-shot category learning of common object names, which is well-formed in children by two. Okay, so all this makes me think of, to move along quickly here, that of Herb Clark's 1973 chapter, Space, Time, Semantics, and the Child. And I firmly believe, and actually Herb agrees with me, that he was the first true embodiment theorist, okay? And what he argued was this, he was talking about space, but it generalizes to talking about 3D representations of objects, what it means to be an object. What you can do with an object is, he said, what the child knows about space is given that he lives on this planet, has a particular perceptual apparatus, and moves around in a characteristic manner. The exact form of this knowledge, then, human knowledge of space, is dependent upon man's biological endowment, that he has two eyes, ears, etc., stands upright, likes to look with heads and eyes aligned to the center of the visual field, and so on. And this, he says, in this sense, it's innate, but of course it's not innate in an obvious sense. It's emergent property of how the body works in a physical world. Okay. All right, to my last point goes on, I just want to say a little bit more about the constraints of space, time, and context on physical behavior. As many of you know, all of you know, I can't believe anybody does not know, complex dynamic systems, 10, which is what we are, okay, brain, body, the behavior it generates and the input that comes back in. Complex dynamic systems generate events in time that are characterized by a suite of statistical properties. This is true, as Zip described, of almost every form of human behavior, conversations, the places we visit, infant toy play, what we eat at mealtimes. But it's characteristic of any complex dynamic system where each moment depends on the history. Multiple factors in the history and its history, earthquakes, for example. All right. So I think this is much more important than anybody, particularly anybody in artificial intelligence, which hardly ever tends to the structure of the real world data, thinks about. But if you take some time series of behavior, and here I'm using toy play as my little example, but it could be earthquakes, okay? Or it could be the words in text. So you have a series of events, those little colored lines in the middle. And they're generated in real time, one moment to the next, one moment to the next, one moment to the next, okay? No overarching plan, no prescription, okay? And these patterns show really characteristic features, okay? They show extremely skewed distributions in which a few things, a few types, are very, very prevalent, and most are very rare. They show periods which could be described as points of repetition or continuity or exploitation, if you like those theories. And they describe or periods of exploration where there's a whole bunch of diversity in what's done. And it seems to be just one different thing after another. You can find those in these streams too. They're characterized by repetition and spacing, bursty, and, okay? They form a whole coherence. That is, when you connect the predictive relations of one item to another, they often have a structure, sometimes small world, sometimes other more interesting things. But they have a predictive structure that puts a coherence over the whole, okay? It's not like just a random little bits of event. There is a coherence. And so we have been looking at this in children's toy play. And these are 12-month-old infants. I'm going to give you just a quick view of this data. These are 12-month-olds who are within 2 weeks of their first birthday, 2 weeks before, 2 weeks after. They don't talk and they play. So we put them in a room with their parents all by themselves, parent and child. We dump 33 toys on the floor and we ask them to play with them, okay? Do whatever they want. They can play with all the toys, none of the toys. They can, kid can play alone, parent can play, whatever. But we get very characteristic patterns. And this is just, there's a little path, you know, this is happening in time, okay? So it's just one moment to the next, one moment to the next. All right, I just said that to you. So here's some basic statistics. First of all, we get extremely skewed distributions. You know, the standard, this is not surprising. Everything does this. Every human generated behavior just about. This is the structure of our world and its statistical properties. So that's, these are the proportion of handling events for child handling with the objects ranked by the most frequently played with by the child, second most frequently. Different children play with different objects. There's no overlap. They all select different things. Parent handling of objects shows a very skewed distribution as well. Parent referencing of objects, that is talking about an object or naming an object, shows the same properties. But the interesting things is these are really correlated. So within, and we do all our correlations within individual subject, and they're all reliable, okay, individually. Parent, this is, you know, parent rank is a function of their own child's rank, strongly correlated. Child's rank is a function of what parent talks about, strongly correlated. Parent rank of what they're handling in terms of what they're talking about, strongly correlated. This is a very deeply organized and coherent system in terms of child's physical action, handling, parent physical action, handling, and parent talk. There's no child talk because they don't talk yet. And this structure is created because they're influencing each other. So at each time, what anybody does next is tightly, tightly related to what the other partner has done. So this is a cross recurrence plot is giving the mean recurrence. If they do everything simultaneously, okay, they would be at zero. If they talk, child reached, parent talked all at the same time. And if the child leads, currents will be positive. If the parent leads, the currents plot will be, the lag will be negative. As you can see, what they do is very close in time. We are seconds, half seconds, fractions of a second apart for if one partner touches an object, then the other will or will talk about it. And you can see that it's a very symmetric recurrence plot, that is both of these entities are equal players. The child leads a little bit, okay? That is, mom's more likely to follow in on what the child's doing, but it's really a very symmetric, okay? So this is not just correlated over the long term, this is moment by moment in time, okay? These patterns are generated because each partner's influencing what the other partner does next. And then when you look, these are individual child and parent networks. If you just look at child handling, you see these are, I'm only showing links that are had repetitions at least three times, okay? And I'm not showing when they go back on themselves. That is when they play with the horse and play with the horse and play with the horse. But all the children show well-structured networks. There are really predictive relations in these networks. That's all that this is showing you. Of the 33 toys, these are the most frequently played with toys, and the orange are the less frequently played with toys. And the parents just add more structure, okay? They do the same structure and they sort of add more links within it. So the top networks are below. But the point I want to make is across all these random little moment to moment to moment, play with a different toy, go back and play with the same toy, go back again. There are predictive relations that build a kind of coherence, like a story. This is what you'd see if you were doing center structures or the words and stories. You would see predictive relations. Some things repeated over and over again. They're your like topics and other little novel events that come along. And that's exactly what this play is like. So this is actually a stream from one child, and I know exactly what's happening here. He's got the cow, cow's walking along. He takes a hammer and he hammers the cow. This is a kind of interesting relation. It's gonna show up a lot here, but these are one-year-olds. Hammering cows with a hammer is actually a step in learning. He's got the hammer again, he put the hammer again. Okay, then we have the boat. Mom actually names the boat here, the boat. We got the little giraffe who wanders around. Giraffe comes up to the boat, plays with a little giraffe, then to the boat, then we go back to cows and hammering cows, okay? This is what it actually looks like. There's these systematic little relations repeated over the thing, and periodically, I don't have one in here, they do something weird. They bring in the hippo once and hammer him, okay? This is what it looks like. That's what these predictive relations are about. Now, these might not be the semantic relations you're interested in, but for a one-year-old, they're actually right. They're about affordances, what you can do with something. If you can hammer a cow, you can hammer a hippo. Okay, kind of getting the generality of the points. All right. Okay, so here I'm coming to the end of my time, I know. So the question we might want to ask next is, what is generating this and what are the consequences for learning? And I think what's happening here is you have at your, whatever is inside the parents and the child's head, okay? It's generating experience each moment in time, okay? Which influences what happens next. So here's what we're trying to do now when we're, okay, well, so here's how we're thinking about it, is we're trying to build a model that can explain both how behavior is generated in real time by each of the participants and their influence on each other, and explain learning. And we're working from modern views of working memory, which see working memory as persistent activation that can lead to rapid one episode learning for things that are persistently activated. So this comes from the kind of modern view of the complementary learning system. In the old complementary learning system, you had, the rapid learning from the hippocampus, which replayed at night. You could do very slow, gradual learning without the hippocampus. It's not clear how functional babies' hippocampuses are. There's anatomical and lots of questions. It's an open thing, I don't want to say, but there is a form of learning in which you can slowly and incrementally learn without involving the hippocampus, which is called cortical learning. But recently it has become clear, and this is mostly from animal work, that there is persistent activation. When there is persistent activation among neocortical areas, that's all these things in green, sort of reverberations around the many areas of the brain, that will support rapid formation of cortical learning, and it does not require the hippocampus, okay? Now this persistence kind of reverberating around here that allows for the formation of durable and expressible cortical memories, sort of the modern day idea of what working memory is this persistence inactivation. The work with animals clearly shows that it is strongly associated in contexts in which there is action, because what action builds is predictive relations between what you're doing and what happens next, and that builds persistent activation. That it is strongly associated with items that emerge in social interactions. The ideas about social interactions is it puts in other predictive components that keep this persistence reverberating. So I did this, my mom does this, it fell, I do this, it fell. It just keeps building these persistent activations across different regions of the cortex. The context is multimodal. That just means it recruits a lot of different parts of the brain, which is needed to keep persistence going as they feed back on each other. And the items are repeatedly activated through pattern completion. That is, you know, I take the cow and it makes me think hammer. Okay, so I go get the hammer, right? And if you have those, that predictive relation, whatever, these build very strong memories, okay? So the idea is that the emergence of this in real time can explain why the child picks up the cow and then goes again like they did 4 minutes earlier for the hammer to hammer the cow, and why the mom goes back to an object when she does or says something about it when she does, that the whole pattern should be explainable by working memory activations, because working memory activations are what drive looking behavior, reaching behavior, and the momentary goals of the organism. But at the same time, this model of working memory, or this working memory viewed in this way, should also be forming the memories that make knowledge. Right? One thing. Whoops. So excellent. This is
and
what
I'm Linda, I'll just let you know, we're cutting quite a bit into questions, so we should probably wrap up.
I'm gonna go.
Possible, because I know everyone model. Will have discussion.
I know, we do have a model, and we're a mathematical model, and it's working, sort of. We got stuff to do. And so this is that. And then I will stop here. These are things that I thought about that sort of came up earlier in the first 2 days that I thought one might want to go back to. In light of what I said. Okay, sorry, I went over.